using microphones. I'm usually pretty loud on my own, but we'll make do. But while we're getting everything set up, I want to make a few acknowledgments. We have Ms. Dellis Early Bell here, who played a role in founding the union here at the college. It's very important to note that this is one of the, I think it is the oldest union of its type in the South, unionized campus here at Agnes Scott. It's the very first campus to unionize in the South. It was a women-oriented initiative, and it's still going strong. So that's always worth noting. Don't know how many of y'all are history majors, how many of y'all know that much about the campus you're paying thousands of dollars to be on, but that is some important note to make here. So I want to, you didn't want to be pointed out, then they do it. And she really was like a lot of the custodial and staff here are for a lot of the staff, for the students here, really just a nurturing, supportive figure, and still is. So I wanted to convey that appreciation. We also have Ms. Carey. Ms. Carey's back here, so just throw up a hand there. She served a similar role in terms of making Agnes livable, making Agnes work. And how many years were you, how many years of service did we put into Agnes?
43.
43, all right, not a small number, y'all. And I've got Helen Cox, who is also a student agitator here for the Living Wage Campaign. Throw up a hand. You have a lovely dress, make sure people can see you. And I also want to note the faculty and staff that are putting in a nice effort, nice presence here. We got Dr. Nathan Grigsby, who has put in 30 years at the campus here with Joyful Noise. Looking sharp over there as always. And we also want to acknowledge Calvin Bergamy, who is heading the camera here, trying to make me look good as best as you can. It's always important to note, we do put a great emphasis with our paperwork and with our some of the rhetoric and some of the documentation that we're putting out on the low-wage hourly faculty and staff, but when it comes to livable wages, we've got a lot of adjunct faculty. We have a lot of staff that's in the academic arm of the campus that are not meeting the livable wage needs that they need to have yet. So they need to be acknowledged and appreciated as well. And we've got Dr. Jan Willis here. And I remember you spoke at an MLK convocation when I was a student, so I'm so glad to see you on the payroll. Very good to see you. And let's see, and I've got some local union social justice rights folks that are here. Peter, who I just met. And I don't remember everybody's name. We got the free MC here. You're gonna work on what you got.
Doing great.
And we're gonna go ahead and hop into our program because we're gonna aim to get the Zion. Zion, if you can smart here, throw up a hand here. Beautiful voice, beautiful part of Joyful Noise. She's going to make her contribution about 11:55. Make sure I stay on time. And then about 12:30, we've got Victoria Wallace. She's also going to be making her contribution there at the back. We're going to make sure they get their acknowledgement. We're taking a multifaceted approach to this social justice movement and to this program. So throughout, make sure that your voices are joyful and get heard as well. We have an open mic for any questions or any comments anybody wants to put in. I mentioned the 1065. That was the case, that wage, that was cited back in 2009, 2000?
The video's from 2007.
So the video's from 2007. So when we're talking about making sure that wages are livable, thinking about time and making sure that the metrics that are utilized to determine what is considered poverty, what is considered a livable wage by the powers that set such numbers, make sure those aren't frozen in time. A lot of them are. A lot of the metrics that determine what defines somebody as impoverished, like 30% of your living costs or devoted to housing and so forth, that was set back, I'm getting my numbers right, back in the mid-20th century, times are hard, it's 2018, things are a lot different in terms of finances than it used to be. So I did want to emphasize that we've got a lot of paperwork that you can take home with you here on the table here, along with our sign-in list, added to the mailing list here so you get updates on what's going on with Living Wage Campaign. Mr. Moe, we're good to see you. I haven't seen you in a minute. And he snuck in. I want to say hello to him. So make sure we're grabbing this because this chart kind of gives you an idea of what it is, what we're aiming for, what kind of wages, what kind of earnings are sustainable and not sustainable if you're talking about paying rent, fluctuating in rent, as well as with kids and how that has an impact as well. And then we did want to go over Dr. Pippin. We wanted to go ahead and hop into the music. Let's go ahead and get to that music. I'm eager to hear it as well. A little bit about, we're going to go ahead and have Zion go ahead and sing. And
about what year are you, if you don't mind me asking?
First year.
First year.
Fantastic. We got first year. Zion Martin coming up to the mic. She is going to be singing a selection. And of course, I left the notes that are relevant to that over there. Thank you so much. The You Are Good medley by Todd Galber. And such poise, such a powerful, beautiful voice from such a first year. Very great job. I was not nearly as well put together when I was in position. So do your thing. We're going to cede the floor to Ms. Zion Martin. Round of applause. Please. Social justice and living wage, a lot of it is rooted in the churches, in the Catholic Church. So I want to make sure this is a welcoming space, a safe space for all types of folks who are willing to hear us out, bless us with their presence. But it's important to note that there is a true mandate in terms of human rights and in terms of acknowledgement, whether that be from a divine orientation or from just a general respect for human beings. For a lot of folks, their respect for human beings and equal treatment is rooted in their background, their religious philosophy and their spiritual orientation. But definitely wanted to acknowledge that, and then reading up on Mother Jones and some other independent research you can do on your own is a lot to learn about that. So I wanted to do a little bit more. What are we pulling up now, Dr. Pittman?
I'm just pulling up the sound.
fantastic. We got Decaturish giving us some love. Hopefully we'll have some folks wandering in, joining us. And once again, that open mic is still open. We are encouraging folks, along with a nice little brief. We have some speaking notes for you. If you wanted to say a few words or prompt any questions, do feel free to do so. Otherwise, I wanted to try to tick off a very dear friend of mine that I'm looking straight at, who is also played a key role in a lot of the momentum that we were able to build during the 2006-2010 era of the Minimum Wage campaign. I'd like to have Ms. Helen Cox come on up, class 2010. Better dressed than me.
But I mainly wanted to prompt the audience with two questions. What is a livable wage? Which is a question we can answer well enough, either factually with some of the details we have on the table, and then through our own experiences, wages that allow you to live your life without any compromises, without any extra support. And then there's also the question, which is a deeper question, has deeper implications, of what is work? What do we value? What contributions are considered visible? Whose contributions get seen more and get lauded more than others? And what contributions keep an institution like this functioning and worthy of lauding and worthy of praise? So I want to see what your answers are when it comes to the what is work question.
Okay. To me, I think that work is really anything that we put our time and our substance toward. So it can be emotional labor, it can be physical, it can be making sure that the floors are clean, and it could be making sure food is made, and all of these jobs are so important and integral to all of our lives, and yet they're oftentimes discounted. And so I think the work on this campus was so lovely to be a part of because we were able to build relationships with as students, with workers, as faculty, and we were able to build a community. And to me, that's what was really special about this. And to me, I think relationship building is at the root of why we need to continue this work. And that's how I think that people really change. And that's how I think power gets changed. And so it's been, I mean, it was eye-opening for me to be a part of this campaign. And to value the different types of work and to understand it. And I just feel really grateful for that. The only people that I continue to keep in touch with are living wage folks from college. And I don't think that's an accident. It's because I became family. So even if I'm a bad child and sometimes don't call people like I should, I will be better. And I feel really grateful for that. It's a long-winded answer, but.
Oh, excellent. I guess I'm going to flesh it out. There are two elements to work that I mentioned, what is valued and what is visible. When we're talking about conversations within social justice about work, how it should be paid for, how it should be acknowledged, there's usually a dichotomy, there's usually a split based on who you're talking to. What work is considered worth a certain amount of money, and what work yields the most benefit to the greatest amount of people. Skylar Washington, you couldn't really hear her. She has like this nice, beautiful, ruddy voice, but it was awful to hear in terms of our audiovisual capabilities. She would kick my butt if she heard me say that. But she was mentioning how she spoke to Ms. Veronica, who played, who would handle Winship and Walters when we were students here. She talked to Ms. Veronica more often than she talked to the professors or to her own faculty advisors. About adjusting to being in Atlanta, coming from Louisiana, having all the pressures of being the oldest child in the family, and just those kind of connections really get made to such a huge, unspoken, profound extent with the custodial. So, because that's a very intimate relationship. That work is valuable to means that can't really be easily quantified by the Bureau of Labor Statistics, but it's something that keeps alumni like myself coming back and looking for that staff. They're the first people I look for whenever I'm back.
And that's one thing I'm really noticing now. So since I graduated in 2010, I've been doing union and nonprofit work, but I'm now making the transition to school counseling, which is really interesting. But the part that I think is particularly important is building relationships. relationships as a school counselor with bus drivers, with custodial staff, with cafeteria workers, because oftentimes you're right, they do know the kids better than anyone else, and they're going to know what's up. And that's something that I haven't seen valued as much within the profession. I feel like they are, you know, they are mental health workers. And so I think that we've all got to work together to make sure our kids are okay.
And then just making sure that we have the institutional backing. We're not just saying a lot of pretty words. We're not just putting emphasis on lip service in terms of living honorably, but making sure that how things are administered are done so honorably. That's really like a key element that we would, it sounds a lot. One of our teach-ins ended up in us marching across campus and crashing a board of trustees meeting. I only mention that because there's a lot of them on campus, given today's the Founders Day convocation, as worth mentioning. And we've got the advent of a new president coming on board, I believe, beginning of next semester, next year. So make sure we put up the, I'm so sorry, I am all so out of touch. I'm just trying to survive on the outside. Who's the new president? Anybody remember? Leah Colia Zach, that's the last name, President Zach, all right. Looking forward to seeing that installation when it comes about, but this is even more reason to make sure with this turning a new leaf, this turning of a new administration, that we turn up the heat, and start getting her feet to the fire, because we pretty much did the same thing with President Keish. President Keish came on to Agnes Scott the same year that we came on his first year. So technically she's part of our class.
Who remembers the welcoming we gave her?
So that whole year
we had been forming a relationship with President Keish, and we had conversations. They weren't really going anywhere, which didn't really surprise us. But what we were able to do when she was finally inaugurated in April is that we had a presidential welcoming, and so we got the backing of United Students Get Sweatshops, which Neil was a part of at the time, also, or maybe not that. But we were all connected. So we got people from across the country to call and fax and email in, and we shut down their systems because of so many messages saying, welcome President Keish, you know, now do the right thing. So that was really the first time that we escalated with her being in that seat. And it was fun. And it was the start of, you know, an ongoing campaign that was really applying pressure along the way.
And it was a great emphasis, a great way to remind the wider community that being involved in the Living Wage campaign, it's great if you can attend the hour and a half teach-in throughout all the way through, but that's not practical for most of y'all, and that's not practical for most of the faculty and staff. So we have regular meetings, we have our demonstrations, we have our mailing letters, we have our Facebook presence, we have our YouTube presence that you can utilize, and then we utilize that to mobilize at times of great action, like that call in, like the marches that we had. And is this important, like your being continuing to be aware of little ways to question what you can push back against is going to be key.
Well, Jillian, I think you brought up a really good point within the video, talking about how the connection to our staff, it was, you know, how Agnes Scott treats its workers is often how it treats its students as well.
And on that note, and I, once again, I apologize for my appearance there. It was finals, and I just, most of the students, the closer you get to the end of the semester, the less you really care about how you look on camera. Had a do-rag and a hoodie, I'm proud of it. But what I was referring to was like my first day on the campus. Family was here, we were unloading, getting up to Walter's second floor, moving in. And I had a parent, not a person of color, but she was demanding to know why there wasn't enough toilet paper in the campus bathroom, in the bathroom, in the hall. And I was like, ma'am, I don't even know where the bathroom is. I'm just moving things in. I'm trying to assemble a bed. Let's see if we can find someone who can assist you with that. And I haven't had parents raised in Jim Crow South, understanding the history of institutions that were founded by a Confederate colonel, basically. It's a little hard to not be, I wasn't necessarily offended by it because I saw it coming, if I could be honest with you, but that did inform my involvement in organizations like the Living Wage Campaign, as well as being co-president for 4 years of the Black Student Association here at CASI. It's hard to not see yourself identify yourself in certain groups. Like, I'm never going to extricate myself, regardless of what money or what degrees I ever get, from those that look like me and have the most relevant experiences to my experiences. So the things that happened with Ms. Della, with Mr. Mobley, I felt them. I felt a personal responsibility to speak up for them. And that's the kind of thing that we want to emphasize with Living Wage, making it a multifaceted, inclusive message and environment. We need everybody to truly see themselves in the fate and in the treatment of others who aren't exactly like them. Because we're more alike than we think. And when we do that work together, we do that collective work, the results that we can yield are just powerful, continue to be powerful. And I'm not sure what else we can add to that. All right. So I did want to acknowledge current students. These old fogies have been up here running our mouths. Thank you so much, Ellen. We wanted to see if there are any current Living Wage campaign participants that we could acknowledge and maybe that would give us an idea of what's been going on. On campus. Do you know anybody or you want to give some acknowledgement in that sense?
Yeah, we're rebuilding the movement. Like many college and university campuses, student leadership comes in waves, and they're about to experience a resurgence. And thanks to our alumni for being here to help. Sometimes we got to bend the arc toward justice together, right? But I want to not acknowledge our community partners who are here, who have dropped in and may have to, go off to other things. We've got Atlanta Jobs for Justice and Neil Sardana, and we have Paul McLennan with WRFG 89.3 FM Labor Forum, and Della and I, they hosted us on the Labor Forum on Monday, for which we were very grateful, and also aired our PSAs. We've got Ann Olson from Atlanta Human Rights, and the Atlanta Living Wage Campaign. We got, of course, Mrs. Della Shirley Bell now.
And, she's still Miss Della, no matter what.
Miss Carrie Wells, John Bobley. I want to acknowledge y'all's presence in the room. And just open the mic up. We want to know why people are here. Give gratitude to everybody who's in the room. There's also, I want to point out on the table before I quit talking, let other people talk. One of the things that instigated this teaching, or at least gave it momentum, was an email from President Keech last August, where once again, living wage discourse had been co-opted by the administration and the board, saying that they had committed to living wage. And so three of us on the faculty wrote a letter to President Keech, and Beth Holder, who's the chair of the Board of Trustees, and you can see that letter on the table. We did not get a response to our letter. So we, Peggy Thompson, Martha Reese, both retired faculty in English and Anthropology, respectfully. Peggy Thompson and I met with President Keech and had a nice meeting, but nothing was accomplished. And we talked to her quite forcefully about the opportunity she had to make a real legacy in terms of liberal arts colleges and historic women's colleges in particular. She quit paying poverty wages to women and undid, the structural racism that keeps the hierarchies and the divisions here. She would really have a legacy. She heard us, but I think the power structure is just too great for that kind of change, so it has to come from below. We are the below standing here today. So you can see that letter. We wrote a second letter. We never got a response. We never got an email. Nothing. So we're going to keep talking. We're going to keep walking. We're going to keep moving. We got to move. So I want to welcome Neil and Paul and Ann and whoever wants to come to the mic and speak and say a few words. We appreciate you as community partners because without you, we don't have anything. Right? We're connected with the domestic workers and the home health care workers and the faculty for our contingent faculty movements and the graduate student unionizing with SEIU. It's such a web of relations that we're grateful. y'all
intro, because I know that if you're on some kind of social media, you know about the Fight for 15, and we've got great resources, great links in terms of talking about that particular initiative. And I don't know,
was it Valentine's Day that people did a walkout of the protest in front of McDonald's? Was that
It was on Valentine's Day. It was February 12th.
February 12th.
And that was the 50th anniversary of the Memphis Sound.
All right, so I'm going to have Neil do his thing. Really grateful to have you here. Go ahead and do your thing. Round of applause, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you guys for welcoming me today. And I was just really excited to see this happening and wanted to come and didn't really prepare anything to say, but. You know, as a part of Atlanta Jobs for Justice and the Fight for 15, we definitely always have stuff going on, so I'm more than welcome to invite y'all and share with y'all kind of what we're up to and how y'all can be a part of the Fight for 15, both, you know, citywide and the nationwide movement as well. And so, I don't know if y'all heard this, just last year, the city of Atlanta made a commitment to raise all of its employees' wages up to $15 an hour. Have y'all heard of that? So some of you, okay. So basically, we ran a campaign over the last several years encouraging the city of Atlanta to essentially establish a $15 minimum wage for all of its employees. And, you know, we would actually have asked them to make a $15 minimum wage for the entire city, but we have a state government that's not exactly supportive of living wages and workers, essentially. And they basically passed a law way back in, like, around 2007 or whatnot, to preempt living wages being set by city governments, and literally only allowing the state government to have a say in what minimum wage is in the state of Georgia. And which our state is one of four in the entire nation that's a lower minimum wage than the federal. So our minimum wage in Georgia is only $5.15 an hour. And what we're demanding is literally three times that as a part of the Fight for 15. So we've been, you know, we basically recognizing that cities and counties can't do this minimum wage effort. We basically have come up with a strategy to call on them to at least make their workers, the people that they give paychecks to directly, bring those folks up to 15. And so we've seen this happen. Fulton County did it in 2016. City of Atlanta committed to it last year. The beginning of this year, DeKalb County raised all its workers up to $14 an hour, is committing to moving to 15. And so we're seeing this movement spread in the South, which a lot of people told us when we were calling for 15 that they're saying it was never going to happen, and in particular it's never going to happen in Georgia. So I think we basically did our best to make sure that we proved those folks wrong, and that any worker, no matter what status, no matter what type of job, deserves at least 15, if not more. We're even now looking at what we're calling a reproductive justice wage, where a single person or a single woman with two kids, and you can see it on this sheet, here in DeKalb County, is $28 an hour in living wage. It's not 15. And so we're actually calling on our governments and our representatives to at least pay attention to that fact. We're not saying you have to instate a $28 minimum wage right now, but that we should be on a pathway to covering everyone and to making sure that it's a full family, being able to take care of your family in a holistic way with a real wage, and that the 15 is literally just a start. So we're starting to move beyond 15, but we're at least calling on the 15 as the absolute floor, the absolute minimum that we're going to be meeting. So on February 27th, in our new office, Atlanta Jobs and Justice is going to be developing a strategy to get the state of Georgia to finally raise its minimum wage, and we'd like to invite you all to join us. That will be February 27th at 6 p.m., and it's the new Jobs and Justice office at 420 McDonough Boulevard. It's very close to the federal prison on the south end of Boulevard. And that's going to be a day for us to really kind of look at what we've been able to accomplish on the city level and see what we can do on the state level. There's many bills that have been introduced that actually move the state minimum wage to 15, and so we want to see what kind of provisions we can put in it that could actually be passed, particularly if we can get, you know, better representation in state government in this upcoming election. So that's one opportunity. And then the next day, February 28th, we're going to be celebrating, we're going to be taking action at the Capitol for Black Women's Economic Justice Day. And this is essentially kind of celebrating the intersection between the last day of Black History Month and essentially the next day being the first day of Women's History Month. Essentially trying to bring those histories together to lift up the struggle that Black women are facing in the state of Georgia and to make sure their voices are being heard by our state leaders, and that this demand for living wages and reproductive justice is being lifted up in our community. So we'd like to invite you all to that. That's going to be starting at 9 a.m. at the Georgia Capitol, and you can follow us on Facebook for all the updates and all the information about those two upcoming events. So thank you all.
From Victoria Wallace at 12:30. But I'm very grateful that you brought up that note about the significant amount of corporate pressure that was involved with that. I didn't know that side of the story.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because I've been in Atlanta for 30 years and I'm in Midtown, so you get a good chance to see a lot of the Arthur Blank Foundation and all their involvement with on the West Side redevelopment, and then you see Delta, like the Pride Parades, the AIDS Walk, and you're doing all this humanitarian, it's good advertising for them, and you see what's happening behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And how they're kind of pulling the rug out of the people, the very people they're trying to do outreach to, so that's very important to note. It can be pretty insidious. Mm-hmm. We're trying not to sound like conspiracy theorists, but there's always a connection. All right, but we do once again want to open up the floor to folks who have stopped by and enjoying lunch as well. I didn't mean to single you out. I had to, though. Good to see you.
If you're hungry, there's some food.
All right, Dr. Piven.
Okay, I just want to talk about what a real living wage would be at Agnes Scott. I think now, Della, what did you tell me was base wage? And John Mobley's not in the room. I can't ask him anymore. what, it's around 14 now, and the college takes full credit for that. 1242. Okay.
That's what it was before.
Okay. And that is for people who are not outsourced. So I want to call out some of the outsourcing on campus, in particular the landscapers, Brightview Landscapers. They are the second or third outsourced group. They were outsourced and then they were bought out, etc. For a while, for about 6 years, we were able to have English for speakers of other languages, classwork both intermediate and beginner, and one hour a week, Bobby King from Refugee Family Services, Handicap Tech, Workplace ESOL helped us get the class started. And then with the new outsourcing, we were no longer able to offer that class. But I also want to say they make $8 to $8.50 an hour. And after 13 years, about $12 an hour, maybe. And they used to have 5 sick days and a week's vacation their first year. With the new company, Brightview, they have 0 sick days. The lead landscaper, who's been here 13 years, early December, broke his leg very bad in several places with a mower accident, and will not be able to return until May. But thank goodness for workers' comp, because that's keeping him going. Otherwise, he would probably be out of a job, because there are no sick days. And there is also no vacation. First-year employees. They're also moved around a lot, and they have a lot of things to that job. But we got to talk about some victories with our living wage campaign. One of the victories, which Della and Travis Nolly helped, Steve Guthrie, English professor you saw on the screen, who is now retired. One of the victories was lunch in the cafeteria at employee rate. So rather than pay $8, I think is what lunch cost over there, if you just walk in, it's $3. Well, at the time, Mary Brown Bullock came as president. This was before Elizabeth Keys. She declared there was free lunch for salaried staff and administrators, but not faculty. And so everybody was gathered in Evans for lunch, right? And when Mary Brown Bullock came, she declared her inauguration that everybody would get free lunch. Well, Della Sue showed up at my door telling me it wasn't everybody. She didn't get included in everybody. And so we were sent by, there was a union rep involved, and Della and Travis and others. Steve and I were sent to go talk to Mary Brown Bullock and call by anti-racism training. It was useless when the president said, about facilities, but they're the happiest people on campus. And so we went from there. It was Della and Travis who had a meeting with the president a year and a half later. A year and a half usually is the amount of time when we're really working hard to get things done. And so everybody got included in lunch, but then everybody had to pay a dollar. And that was after Steve and I did what was the easiest protest ever on the planet. I didn't bring in my lunch anyway every day. We just wrote a letter respectfully refusing to participate in the free lunch. No hardship at all. That didn't even scrape the surface with the president. But then $1.50 and now it's up to $3. We have worked to get that graduated kind of payment so that, for example, Della doesn't pay as much as I pay. So that was a victory. And then with the landscapers, who are mostly Latinx men with families, married with children, most of them, they're told not to talk to Agnes Scott students. Well, the ESOL class broke that down in some wonderful ways, and we formed some great relationships in that class and learned a lot from each other. It was transformative for me in many ways over those 6 years. I got to eat lunch with them in Evans was the best day of my 29 years of teaching at Evans School. So we have had some victories. The first teach-in, we were able to raise wages somehow with a faculty and two students. And community partners from Columbia, you'll see our joint statement with Columbia Seminary, which has a lot of God talk at Columbia Seminary, that Marcia Ricks and I drafted back in 2002, a long time ago. Over on the table, you can read it. Their faculty passed the living wage, but of course, they don't have the living wage either. But we have reconnected with Columbia, and I hope they show up today because we share landscapers together. That was a victory. The wages, Della can correct me because she has a better mind on this, from $9 to $10 an hour. Della at the time was making $10-$12 an hour after 36 years here, I think, somewhere thereabout. So there were some compression issues. Also, the Aramark staff, which we believe were hired to union bus, but you mentioned they messed that up by 4 years ago now, joining the SEIU union. They were very, very happy because they got equalized with somewhat with Agnes got, not in terms of benefits, but in terms of pay. And even though a dishwasher who just come on was making the same as a grill cook, they were going to let them know because the votes had lifted. And then
and having children are contracted staff.
Yes, children are contracted staff too. And then, within a week, their hours were reduced. So we're always dealing with fronts on this, victories, and sometimes short-lived. The real victory is that, as Jillian and Ellen have already talked about, are the relationships. So let's hear from some others. We got some. Oh, we need to do the music.
Yes. All right. Thank you very much again, Dr. Dinner, for those insights. I want to go ahead and cede the floor to another powerhouse, impressive contribution. And remind me again what year you are. You are a senior. You ready? Get on up out here. I love it. All right. This is Victoria Wallace with Andre Day's Rise Up. Not to be confused with the Falcons right here. But we're talking about victories, we're talking about social justice and continuing movement. We gotta remember to rise up. So here, no further ado, Ms. Wallace, Victoria Wallace.
You're broken down and tired, living life on a merry-go-round. And you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we're gonna walk it out and move mountains. We're gonna walk it out and move mountains. And
mountain.
light of the egg, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you.
Really see that powerhouse performance once again. Do not miss out the opportunity to find out about what is going on here. We've got the Living Wage campaign teaching going on until about 1 o'clock. If you've missed most of it or you want to find out when we're doing this again, feel free to sign up for the email list here on that table. And then before you go, make sure that you pick up this valuable piece of information. It gives you insight into what's a living wage, how it's calculated, how that's impacted at the Scott faculty staff here, and then what we're seeking and what other elements we've got going on as well. And we've got Dr. Pippen here again, Rich Studies. She's going to say a few words.
Yes, I have something fun to report. Apparently, we are interrupting the President of Keisha's speech right now. Ooh. Upstairs. So we are being disruptive, y'all, so let's hear it.
Know who you are, it's going to be a good chance to don't say your name, say your year if you are a student, and yeah, just go for it. Give yourself about 2 minutes to speak.
Awesome. Hey y'all, my name is Emma Fisher. I am a junior here at Agnes Scott, Religion and Social Justice major. Yes, Religious Studies represent. And I am here because A, I believe in a living wage, and B, it is unfathomable to me that Agnes Scott does not. But before I get into that, real quick, if you're on Twitter, so are we, follow us at LivingWageASC on Twitter. Hashtag all you millennials, get out your phone, follow us on Twitter. But when I talked to my mom about the idea of me raising trouble as part of the Living Wage campaign, she was like, yes, go. Because when you think about the idea of an institution paying poverty wages, it is disgusting in any context. But when you take the context of Agnes Scott, who we say we are and what we say we believe in, equality, inclusivity, justice, engaging with the social and intellectual challenges of our times, the fact that we as an institution perpetuate poverty and are paying people poverty wages just gets that much worse. People say that we have unrealistic expectations based on what other colleges are doing around the country. I don't really care about other colleges. I care about Agnes Scott. I want Agnes Scott to be the best that we can be, and the best that we can be is an institution that pays equity. Yeah. That's all I have to say. If you want to get in touch with the Living Wage campaign, we are on Twitter, Instagram, and we have an email, ASCLivingWage@ASCLivingWageCampaign@gmail.com. Like I said, we're on Twitter. We're also on Instagram. Keep your eyes out. Yes. Tina, what is the next gathering meeting / teaching?
Soon.
The student group is going to be organized.
TBD. Yeah. So we will figure that out. But yes, please, if you sign up for emails, follow us on social media. This is far from the last time that you will be hearing from us. Woo!
Anybody else feeling disruptive? That's kind of our claim to fame here. Making people upset, disrupting things, crashing meetings, all types of stuff. any kind of contribution. Come on up.
Yes.
There you go. I'm feeling motivated right now. I like this momentum you started.
All right, go for it.
Hi, my name is Alex Brown, class of 2019. I'm a writer for Campus Agnes Scott, which is our college magazine, and I'm doing a story on the Living Wage campaign. So if you'd like to come talk to me about your own story or what you're doing or why you're here, please come talk to me. So I would love to have your voice in the article. And unfortunately, I wasn't able to be here for the beginning of it because I was in statistics class. But yeah, go ahead and talk to me if you would like to.
Alright, so we do have members from the press here, that's good to know. So you're with Campus, the Campus magazine. Her Campus. Okay, that wasn't around when I was here. Is Profile still a thing?
Yes, the Profile is still a thing.
Is Profile here or present? Represented? Would you like to come up and say a few words?
I'm afraid not.
Are you open to people coming up to you and leaving some comments about today's events? All right. And if they can email you, if they're not able to reach you, what's a good address for you?
Cgold@agnesscott.edu.
Gold.
Gold.
Gold like the campus ring.
Yeah.
@agnesscott.edu. All right. Y'all be sure to follow up with her. Follow up with Alex, you say? And put in some notes. We'll get this into the record as well, because there will be more of these to follow and make sure this is documented. It's a very rich part of the campus history, this agitation, this disruption. And I'm so glad that she was singing so powerfully. It's like, that was great. She didn't really need that microphone, did she? You noticed she was holding back from it. It's like, you're going to break that. I like that. So we are going to see if we can get some other folks to speak and contribute. We have a bold, courageous, I kept looking over at you.
Exactly.
Are you sure you introduce yourself to speak?
Go for it. I think I tend to be so loud, I'm afraid to put my voice on the microphone. I'm Jennifer Lund in the Center for Global Learning. And I don't think that what I have to say is very disruptive. I think it's just very understandable that we're a well-resourced institution, we're a well-resourced country, and it is our ethical and moral obligation to provide living wages to people who work. And so I think that's just kind of basic, but that's what I believe, and I think it's what many people believe. So, not the most agitated or disruptive thing I've ever said. So at any rate, it's right and just for all to have a living wage.
All right, I don't know about our burgeoning journalists, but I wrote that down. We are a well-resourced campus. All right, here we go. Because that does speak very highly in terms of, oh, come on up. They just want me to bring it to you.
Well, no,
hold on. I'm coming to you. We're going to make sure you're on the record.
Just to let the students know that don't know me, my name is Julie Peter. Right now, I am primarily I'm the one that works in the back. But right now, I'm working 213 with Trailer and all the hospitals. I have been here 17 and a half years. So you ladies need to see me for anything, feel free. My address is dbostic@agnesscott.edu.
Thank you.
My telephone number is 440-437-8663. And I'm here from 2:30. But right now I'm in HR, so I'm here from 8:30 to 4:30. Feel free to call me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, and do make sure that y'all add your names to the sign-up sheet here on the table. And Ms. Bostic, very glad to see you. I didn't know I thought I was gonna miss you.
And
I like how this, y'all, please visit Ms. Bostic, because she's got this sparkly thing going on with her hair. It is fierce. And she's always been like this burst of like energy to all the gatherings, all the meetings we had her at. And in terms of getting some real institutional knowledge, not just about the Living Wage campaign, but about Agnes itself, you gotta start here with the source and here with Ms. Della. I'm gonna emphasize Ms. Bostic because Della is no longer at campus on a regular basis. But she's also somebody that could also bring in some dirt as well. But all right, thank you so much for that, for those notes and for being here. Let's keep it rolling, y'all. What else do we want to say? What else we got on our minds, our hearts, our souls? All right, because we've got, that was kind of hard to follow, that well-resourced campus. I like that. It speaks very highly in terms of institutional priorities. What do we, what's going on?
And hypocrisy.
Right, exactly. And that's one way that it can be highlighted. Right? What are you emphasizing over the other? And I'm glad that we brought up the new, I guess it's new, it's not really new to y'all, but back in our day, it was ValleyCrest was providing the outsourced lawn care and the maintenance care. We talked a lot about the million-dollar grass here at Agnes, how it's perpetually green, it's beautiful, it's well-kept. And I guess now it's more like billion-dollar grass. We have to adjust for inflation. But we had a lot of movies, a lot of disruptive movie film shoots here. We have a lot of stories about people getting angry, like being treated like extras on their own campus. But that's worth noting because it is because of the efforts of the Brightview staff that make this campus shootable, filmable. And for them to not be getting no sick days, no kind of recourse for an injury on the job, save for workers' comp. Make you feel a certain type of way that's not positive. A little cringeworthy on that. I'm donating money at least once a year. I don't like where that's going. So definitely very grateful for those insights being shared. And we want to see about more insights, more input from the guests, no matter what. Even if you're just coming over to Black Cat grabbing some coffee for Dr. Pippin. Don't mean to call you out. I was hoping you had one for me, but no. The floor is going to continue to be open. We are getting close to shutting things down, but we're going to continue the conversation even though the official time for the event will be ending about 1.
I want to call attention to this sheet of news print from 2015, one of our Living Wage luncheons. Seems like in every lunch I learned something that knocks me. And this lunch we did some goals setting, and you can see what your needs are. Not only more pay, but respect to women. Because at the time there was one custodian who was yelled at by a supervisor and cursed at. And so I guess that was a victory being made there. Because these things often are invisible and go unspoken. So issues of better equipment, some of the custodians at the time, and that may still be the case, were bringing in some of their own supplies because the college had opted to buy cheaper materials and not ask the professionals who know what to do. And also dealing with what is called the sticky floor syndrome, where women doing the same job are getting paid less than men doing the same job at the historical scholarship. So we're trying to right some wrongs here and also catch up with the city of Decatur and Atlanta. Atlanta was 15, thank goodness. We're behind. And we could lead all these other historic women's colleges and every other college and university in the state of Georgia if we were to step forward. And not only with wages, but with the whole package of respect and racism and classism. So come on up and let's tell us why you're here and why you care about this issue.
Like you didn't want to speak. No, she needs no introduction. Go on ahead and speak.
Dallas Spurley, bail now. And how long was I here then? It's got to seem like a thousand years.
46.
46?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I come when I was 16. When I first come here, my take-home pay was $19 a week. We have gotten it better since then, but it still can be a lot more. I think the highest paid person now, which is probably just one person, may just be over the 15 now. But that's just one person among a whole lot of people here who do work at Agnes Scott that you wouldn't believe. They're asked to clean 2 and 3 buildings and expected to do it and do it right. The college is not hiring any more people when they really should be, because they're continuing to build buildings and not hiring anybody to clean these buildings, and then getting upset when the buildings aren't clean. It doesn't take a rocket science to figure out, scientists to figure out why, you know, you're not getting the work that you think you need to be getting with the people that you've got here. But we're not mules and horses. So, you know, we just kind of doing the best we can with it. But I'd just like to say one thing. I talked to President Keach at one point. We went to see her in her office, and we were trying to get her to come on board with the Living Wage campaign. And at that time, she said she would do what she could, but she had a boss also, the Board of Trustees. And at that time, I really thought she had more power than what she thought she had, because she had just got here. And Board of Trustees, this was the perfect time to ask for what you thought you needed to run your campus better. But it didn't resonate with her like that. And I just have a challenge to her now. As part of her legacy at Agnes Scott, I'm asking that she does what she promised me that she would work on when I retired. I pulled her aside at one of the retirement dinners that they gave me. And I told her I wanted her to continue to work on the Living Wage campaign. Well, now it's time for President Keach to make this a part of her legacy, to give the lower paid people on this campus that you expect to do much more work than they are equipped to do with the bodies they have. You about kill them. But my challenge is that you at least make the base pay for all employees at Agnes Scott $15 an hour. And I think that would be a good legacy for her as president, former president. And I had 7 young women over the years that I was here that I included as my children. And I'm so proud of these two. These are my babies, of all of the ones that I did include as my children, Helen and Jillian. I'm just so proud of y'all. Thank you all. Thank you for coming. Thank you, everybody.
Once again, Della, thank you for the years of dedication and for truly being the linchpin to everything that's been happening, continues to happen. You were on the ground floor, figuratively, literally, spiritually, all the ways you've been on the floor. Help build it, probably help fix it too every now and then. And we're here because of your dedication. Dr. Pippin says the same thing. She speaks like as if it were yesterday about how galvanized she was by your efforts. Right? Becoming a rabble rouser from the faculty side of things. But all right, we are getting close to 1 o'clock, so people need to go to class and things to make that happen. But we want to continue to keep the floor open, continue the dialogue going, continue this question again, whatever contributions we have to the idea of work, what is valued, why it is valued, and what needs to change in terms of the type of work that is valued and that we show value and appreciation of here at this campus. and a campus is in place is light. Seeing some, I did want to pause, make sure that folks who are part of the Living Wage campaign on the student level, on the faculty level, that we haven't already acknowledged, get a chance to raise their hands, get a little acknowledgement going. I just need to know who else is going to these meetings and teach-ins now. It's been 8 years. I see her, very good, very happy. Very happy to know and see that. And yeah. Okay, there need to be more of you though. You can't be the only one.
Well, no, I'm not. I'm not the only student leader. My counterpart, my partner in crime, couldn't be here today. Her name is Anna Bird, but she is amazing and she is 110% dedicated to, you know, fighting for the cause. Absolutely. It would be an honor to be compared to you guys. You know, and I hope that we can, you know, get the ball running, get some stuff accomplished. I think with, you know, President Zach coming in, I have big plans for my first meeting with her. We're gonna meet real quick before she gets, you know, I want to say brainwashed, but brainwashed.
Get to her before they do.
Right, absolutely. To talk about how important of an issue this is, and it's not something that we're gonna sit quietly by and ignore. Absolutely not. You know, one of the things that I think has really prevented the students from engaging with this issue is, in all honesty, I think a lot of students really don't know. I think a lot of students just kind of assume, like, oh, we're Agnes Scott, like, of course we're gonna pay, like, fair and equitable wages, but when confronted with the facts, I think the student body will engage. So we just gotta get that information out there.
Thank you so much. Come on. And as far as what elements that you're seeing that are making you feel positive about, because we gotta focus on the victories. Can't chase everybody away. There's gotta be something happy to talk about. What are some elements about your current situation, your current experience at Agnes? What year are you right now?
I'm a junior and I'm graduating in the summer.
Hot dog, look at you. Early release. I like it. What are some things that you're liking about what you are seeing now, since you'll be transitioning, you'll be moving on to the next big adventure? What's giving you hope for the future in terms of living wage, in terms of social justice campaigns here?
That's a really great question. Definitely the thing that is giving me the most hope and the most inspiration is, you know, the reactions of students that I have talked to. You know, even just engaging with folks over Twitter, when, you know, I approached my friends and I was like, hey, did you know this was a thing? Would you be willing to, like, follow this Twitter, retweet it? You know, people are like, no, I didn't know this is a thing. I'm gonna tell all my friends. There's a real sense of, you know, we kids like to call ourselves quote unquote woke. I think there's a real sense of awakening and, like, you know, realization that's going on, that I think that the momentum from that series of realizations and that awakening is really going to carry us into the future. Also just like the community, you know, people form just over the course of my 3 years here, watching people form bonds with each other, be it students, staff, faculty, everybody in between, the relationships that we are able to forge here at Agnes Scott, because we're such a small school, really do lend themselves well to, you know, taking care of one another, making sure that everyone's needs are met. And I think once we've built the relationships, once we start using those relationships, I think we'll really get things done.
Always just hopeful to see young people, because you're the people that you're talking about, you're those people for me. So yeah, definitely continuing that momentum, continuing to spread the word, just make sure people know, because there's a lot of well-meaning people who are just, I mean, they say the road to hell is paved with good intentions, and the bonding element of that road is going to be ignorance. So I think that's great insight to have. Continue to do what you're doing, continue the Twittering. And then the Facebooking. Are we doing the Instagram?
Instagram.
Okay, so Anna's designated IG person. Fantastic. All right. And as far as the social media efficacy, because really primarily what we were doing was Facebook and texting each other, running into each other on campus, more of these teach-ins, and then YouTube. You feel like the Twitter. This is really like, now there's Snapchat, I have no idea how that works. How do you feel like that has been playing a role in your ability to be responsive and to affect the kind of changes that you feel like have taken place?
I definitely think it plays, social media absolutely plays a huge role in our ability to affect change because it is so fast. You know, if I tweet something, I can get retweets within less than a minute. You know, Snapchat, I was broadcasting live some of the stuff that was going on, so people who weren't able to be here in person could see it on Twitter as a live feed. You know, technology and the social media is really enabling us to engage with people who couldn't be here in like physical bodies, but also it's just so fast. And I think that's one of the things you have to stay on top of it, because if I only tweet like once a week, and nobody will see my tweets. But if I tweet every single day, my chances of engaging people are much, much higher. So social media is absolutely critical to what we do.
And please keep tweeting and twerping and all that stuff. Maybe a little bit of twerking too, you know. But as long as it's for social justice, it's all good. Let folks know that we are here and we are still gonna continue the conversation, because I believe that we want one of the staff to speak at this point, right? Well, yes.
Aramark is part of the movement. They've been part of the movement since we've begun. One of the issues with Aramark that was not a victory, because it was not a victory in the state of Georgia, was that they are 4 months out of the year with no pay, and they can no longer apply for unemployment insurance. The movement went down to the Department of Labor when it happened, and Kelly Grant, who was the grill cook for Aramark in Evan Steinenhall, spoke brilliantly, was on the WSB. The bus drivers, the school bus drivers from Chatham County and Savannah were there. You know, it was a pretty big event. There was a lot of push to get support for school workers who, for winter holiday and summer vacation, were out. And so, as soon as she's off the register, we're going to have an Aramark employee come in and speak. They did unionize with SEIU. They have a better contract. Once every 3 years, they renew the contract. SEIU has been paying, their representatives have been paying more attention to them than our facilities union, Laborers International, has. And call them out for that, because they have the same 5-year contract, exactly the same, just a few words changed for the last 7 years. Just 2 years ago, signed a new 5-year contract, didn't change at all. And so we're not sure what's going on there. There's some collusion with the administration at the start. So we're you know, fighting the fight here, and there are a lot of different mixing trainings in terms of outsourced caterers. Whenever you see a caterer on campus, they make $10 an hour. I want to share something that an alumna of 1966 sent to Peggy Thompson. And this was from the profile of 1965-66, which I was going to send to you. Felicia Guess, who is a distinguished alumna from Agnes Scott, from, I think she's class 1966. In any event, in the profile, she and a couple of other women wrote an editorial about the laundry workers. They used to have laundry workers down in those days, and they used to have the laundry back there with the steam plant. And they had no air conditioning, very little ventilation, and people were getting sick in the summer with the hours. Pay. They were making $23 a week in 1966, and students at the time wrote a letter. And so I looked through the before and after issues of the profiles of newspaper reports, and nothing ever got, you know, that was kind of it. It got kind of left there in 1966. So, of course we pay more, and as the college would say, we pay more than any other institution. Higher education in town. And it's because of the union, because of the student. And students know this already, but it's the real power of the movement in coalition with staff. There are very few of my people, faculty, We're going to be involved. We protest our pain, not our privilege. It's very easy for us to shut our doors. And so you got to work on faculty. You got to get in their ears and hold them, us, accountable. Don't let us slide away. In terms of building the movement, it takes all constituencies. And some of us have the privilege, as I do as a full professor of tenure, to speak, as others do not. So I'm hoping that one of our Aramark staff will be bold and come in and speak. So let's hear from some others in the room. Why are you here? Yes.
While we're waiting. My name is Kristen Kimble, and I'm a sophomore here at Agnescott College, majoring in political science. And I work for State Representative Tara Ellis, and she graduated in 98. And so right now, I was writing a resolution for President Kish, which is congratulating her for all of her accomplishments. And so I was coordinating with the office of the president and the media here at Agnescott, and there's a nice little line that they wanted in the resolution about the living wage policy. And how President Kish has implemented and strengthened our college. And I mean, President Kish, if you're watching this eventually, I respect you, but I'm not going to lie for you. So I will be taking that line out of the resolution.
Good for you.
Yeah. All right. So very powerful, very thank you for that, because that's a hard position to put yourself in. I can see a lot of students, a lot of faculty and staff not feeling comfortable to take part in campaigns like Living Wage, because they feel like they'll be questioned, they'll be undermined, there'll be consequences, repercussions. So it's important that the people who have the least to lose, the students, students and alumni to an extent, play a massive role and make some radical big moves like that. So I commend you for that. Because I can see people who are thinking about their next ability to get their next job. And there's a lot of that pressure. We have a lot of first year college students. We have a lot of people who just simply can't think about being that radical, having the privilege or having the opportunity to do that. So I'm glad that you took that initiative and took advantage of that. And that might be some good rhetoric for us to take advantage of, I think. Let's tweet that. I don't know if I'll actually talk to her about that first. But all right, now in the meantime, we're gonna talk to our Aramark staff here. You're gonna introduce yourself, let us know where you're working, and we're gonna give you a round of applause.
Hello, I'm Sharon, and I work at Black Cat Cafe, and I'm been with Aramark for about 4 years now. And I actually just gave my boss a heads up that this might be the last semester, because I'm tired of struggling. The 4 months in the summertime where we're not allowed to work and Agnescott work is a struggle. I come back in August, I'm trying to play catch up, and then December comes around and we're off for another month. So I'm still trying to play catch up. Then December comes, then we're back in January, and we're almost out of school already. So I'm still not even caught up in the summertime, and I love what I do. Like, I love my job to death, and it hurts me because I have to choose now. I have to do what I need to do for me and my child, but I actually like the work that I do, so it's just like, where can we meet somewhere where I can still do what I love and be able to live? So that's just where I'm at. I don't want to leave you guys. I love it. It's sad. I had to do my part. I know. I love what I do. It's harder. It's really hard. Priorities, what to pay first, because it's just not. Still trying to play catch up. And here I am looking for another job because summer's coming. But that's fine. I hope I'll get to say. I'm now trying to figure out if there's a way I can work 16 hours in a day, but then I have a 2-year-old and he needs my time, which is like working on makeup for the morning without trying to go to another job and stay there. I want to do a better way to stay and live.
Thank you very much for sharing that. And that's just a real tangible detriment when it comes to not investing in livable wages for your staff. They have to leave. They can't contribute the way they want to contribute. And that's one of the things that students, that drive them to this community of living wage campaign over the years, the decades, like genuine love and appreciation of the staff and what they've done. And when they can't do what they want to do, what they love to do, I mean, that's once again talks about what work we value and how we value it, how we are quantifying that value and putting it into practice. I'm really disappointed that young lady is going to be leaving. I mean, especially since I just met her. And it would be like if Bella had left while I was at school, I would have been crushed. I knew you weren't going anywhere. You were too much in the fight, but if you had left, so I can imagine, I felt that. That was palpable. That was a loss.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Oh, sorry. Keep talking.
That's what I meant when I was talking about the power of relationships. You know, like, seeing as part of the community, we love having her, we love seeing her, you know, and having community members have to leave because at the institution refuses to pay a living wage is, no one should have to make that choice between doing what you love and having to, and being able to support your family. It's just, like, why?
And I'm very thankful nonetheless for her contributions. We always want to focus on the positive, focus on the value and the relevance of the people who are central to this effort. And in true living wage fashion, true Agra Scott fashion, we are disruptive, we break bounds, we cross boundaries, we make people upset, we make things uncomfortable. And that note, we have gone over time, but that's what we're gonna do to make sure that all the voices that need to be heard get heard and get included. We break time, we raise hell, we yell like hell, and we make that happen. But while we're gonna go ahead and close things out, I've got some parting words from Dr. Bibbin.
Dr. Nathan Grigsby, and Dr. Noyce, and Calvin Burgundy, and Jillian Wells. Thank you. So let's make some noise so that the president hears.
Do we have any cans?
We have any cans. What are we going to do with that? Yeah, what do you got? Ask me.
So three rounds of what do we want?
Living wage.
What do we want?
Yeah.
All right, and I'm putting the mic on y'all.
Okay.
What do we want?
Living wage.
When do we want it?
Now.
What do we want?
Living wage.
And when do we want it?
Now.
What do we need?
Living wage.
And when do we need it besides yesterday?
Now!
Very good, keep it going. Thank y'all so much.